Good morning. Take in a deep breath of God's presence. I'm Pastor Jeanine Alexander, and on behalf of First United Methodist Church, the Coppertop, and Hillside United Methodist Church, we welcome you to worship on this fall kickoff Sunday. You are going to be delighted and inspired this morning as you hear the choir and the band and Strikepoint, and as you experience a blessing of the backpacks, amongst other things. We are worshiping in spirit, if not in person, and we offer a special welcome to those of you who are joining us for the first time. Already we've been praying for you that this time of worship will provide you a living encounter with God. Please do share this link with others so they too can be blessed by worship. Happy birthday to all of you who are celebrating birthdays this week, and happy anniversary to everyone who is celebrating an anniversary. I encourage you to see the newsletter and emails, web pages, and Facebook pages for fall opportunities, such as the weekly Zoom class with Reverend Mary Ann Korsch on the three general rules, confirmation, which will begin on Wednesdays starting September 30th from 6:30 to 7:30. The third through fifth grade group will meet one Wednesday a month. The middle school group will meet two Wednesdays a month. There'll be Sunday school. There'll be a third grade and three-year-old Bible presentations. There will be choir Zoom meetings. There will be bells. And you can also sign out a socially distanced space at church for 10 people and under. So please do check all those things out. This morning, I have some bad and good news for you. The bad news is Ann Gustafson, our director of operations, is moving to the Twin Cities to be with her family, and she's leaving her role here Friday, September 19th, so we don't have much time with her left. The good news is that she does get to be with her family, and she will do seminary in person. And as much as we will deeply miss her and appreciate all she has brought to us, we do in this church say family first, and we are glad she is following that passion and that calling. Be watching. We will have ways that you will be able to celebrate and thank Anne in the coming weeks. We invite all of you to a Zoom fellowship time after worship today. And we also invite you to drive-in worship this Wednesday, where we'll have a 30-minute service, including a blessing of the animals. So you can bring an animal with you, or you can bring a picture. And now let us worship together as we join in the call to worship.
Good morning, I'm Katie Peterson, and this is my mom, Susan Smart.
Good morning, and this is my mother, Diane Boris.
We are all members of Hillside United Methodist Church. Please join us in the call to worship.
Let us build a house where there is love, kindness, and compassion for all.
Let us build a house where everyone is our neighbor.
Let us build a city where all are named and treasured.
Let us build a country where we listen to each other with an open heart.
Let us build a world where our hands and heart will reach the outcast and the stranger.
Because all are welcome.
All are welcome.
All are welcome in this place, God's house.
Place with welcome. Let that message be imprinted on our hearts and turned into a lived reality. It's one thing to sing it, and it's another to live it. I invite you all now into a time of prayer, a time where we listen and seek God's voice, God's heart, God's vision, and God's dream for us and for all of creation, on earth as it is in heaven. And so let us quiet our minds now in this time of prayer and in this moment of silence. Let us pray. God, we seek you, your wisdom and your guidance. As we move into a new season, our lives are still turned upside down as we live in a global pandemic. God, many of us are tired, tired of making difficult decisions, tired of saying no, tired of being scared. God, we ask for strength and courage to keep going and finding ways to love our neighbors. We ask for strength and courage to live the hope that we are called to live. God, we know that you are in the business of healing and loving. Give us the strength and courage to trust that you are creating something new out of this time of chaos and confusion. God, give us the strength and courage to believe that you hold us, so that we can be a light to the world and salt to the earth and welcome all people. And God, we pray for everyone who is hurting, everyone who is sick, everyone who is in pain, people who are experiencing loss and grief, people who have hit an emotional wall. God, we pray for those who are isolated, those who are lonely and afraid. We pray for all those in the middle of natural disasters, such as fires and tornadoes, hurricanes and earthquakes. God, we pray for all the teachers, the families and the kids as they begin their new schedules of school and distance learning. God, we pray for those who have lost jobs and are looking for work. And we pray for compassion. Oh God, we pray for compassion and kindness so that we can see our neighbor in need and that we could serve them. And we also pray for humility so that we can ask for help and let our neighbor serve us as well. Holy God, we pray all these things in the name of Jesus, the one who taught us how to pray. Loving God, Sacred One, blessed be your name. May your kingdom come, your dream arrive, your purpose prevail on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us the wrong we have done as we forgive those who have wronged us. Help us steer clear of temptation and protect us from evil. We trust you in this, for the kingdom, its power and its beauty are yours forever. Amen.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells.
Hello, everybody. It's that time again. It's Sunday, and you know that is my favorite day. It's time for church. Come on, let's go to church. Yeah, I know. We can't go to church yet. Man, that's so annoying. This time in the beginning of September, we are so used to getting ramped up and starting our Sunday school program and having all the kids and all the new staff and doing super fun things. I know that school looks really different right now. And I know that church looks really different right now too. But just because it's different doesn't mean it can't be fun. It can still be a lot of fun. Well, instead of having a big old lesson for you today, I want to tell you two things. No matter where you are, no matter where you go, God is with you and God loves you. God loves you. God loves you. That was the two things. No matter where you go and where you are, God loves you. The second thing is God is with you. So some of you are getting ready to go to school and you're going to go to school. And God is with you when you're at school. Some of you are going to do school at home, online. God is with you there too. Some of you are in preschool and are going to go to daycare. God is with you there too. So two things. God loves you and God is with you wherever you go. Just say a prayer. Say, hi, God. Boom. Like magic. God is there listening and watching for you every day, all the time, 24 hours. So usually on this Sunday, I do a blessings of the backpacks with Pastor Jeanine. Well, like I said, we can't go to church and do a blessings of the backpacks. So I went out with my video camera and I videoed some of my friends. And today in our children's time, we just get to watch all of our friends from the Coppertop and from Hillside. And all the way at the end, we will say a prayer for all the teachers and all the students and all the parents out there. Take a look. Super cool.
Hi, I'm Jake. I go to Hermantown Middle School. I hope you have a great year.
Hi, I'm Annie. I'm going to learn MacArthur's first grade. I have a matching lunchbox with my backpack.
Hi, my name's Martin and I go to Humcroft Elementary School. I'm going in the second grade and this is my backpack.
Hi, my name is Aaron. I teach at the University of Minnesota Duluth. I went to school for 24 years and I've been teaching college for 23 years. And this is my backpack.
Hi, my name's Noah. I'm in fifth grade at Piedmont Elementary. This is my backpack and...
Hello, Coppertop. It's me, Mike Goodlett, and I've been teaching in the school district of Maple for 30 years. Happy New Year, everyone.
Hey, you. What's your name? What is it? What is it? Are you George?
No.
No? Are you going to third grade?
No.
What grade?
Kindergarten.
Kindergarten. And is your
Hi,
name?
This is Miss Marquardt. I'm getting ready for a new year of school. I have my bag and my laptop and my planner, and I'm ready to make it a great year.
Hi, my name is Delaney, and I'm in fourth grade, and I'm going to Piedmont.
Ah, cool!
I'm Ellie, and this is Ellie, and who's just such a news with my sis, and I'm Ellie. And I'm going to kindergarten.
My name's Elijah, and I'm going to Piedmont. And I'm in second grade, and I'm...
Hi, yes. I'm Abby, and I am actually lucky enough to be able to go into school every other day. So half my days, I'll be sitting here doing my work from home, and the other half, I'll get to be in the classroom.
Hi, I'm Atlee, and I'm going to North Shore Community School. Here's my backpack, and if you think pink is a girl color, you're wrong.
Woohoo!
I'm Sol, and I teach 5th grade STEM at Starbase. This will be my 31st year of going to school.
Hi, everyone. I'm Sage. I'm going to be a sophomore at East High School this year. And while I don't have a backpack, I do have my laptop, which I'll be doing online school on for at least the first quarter of school. I hope everybody is staying safe and staying healthy, and I hope you all have a great school year.
I'm ready for online school.
Hi guys, I'm Ella, and right now I'm just sticking with online school for the first quarter, but we'll see what happens in the second quarter and all that. But yeah, hope you guys have a great school year, and please stay
safe.
Hi,
I'm Kiki, and I'm not using a backpack right now because I'm doing school at home.
Hi everyone, welcome to my home office. My name is Jeff Bell, and I teach in the business school at University of Minnesota Duluth. This is my 45th year of school. Hope yours goes well. Bye.
This is Izzy. She attends eAchieve Academy online. This is her backpack.
Hi, my name is Sam. I'm doing school online this year at Ordine Middle School.
Hi, I'm Sophia. This is my backpack behind me. It's empty because this is my classroom for the next quarter.
I'm Elizabeth, and here I am with my backpack. I got it recently because it has wheels on it, and I need to be able to roll my backpack to school. I am 65 years old, and I have been in school for 60 years. I was in regular school through high school, and then I had 10 years of college because I was kind of slow, and it took a lot of degrees to get to be what I wanted to be, which is a teacher at UMD.
Hey God, I thank you for all the kids that are going to school this year, and I pray that you are with them and that you bless them. And I pray for all the teachers and all the kids that are learning online and all the parents that are helping them. In your name we pray. Amen. 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 Amen.
Friends, today we begin a sermon series called Reclaiming Jesus. We are using the book Christ in Crisis, Why We Need to Reclaim Jesus by Jim Wallace as our jumping point. Some of you read this book this past year in small groups at church, and others of you may have read his New York Times bestseller, God Politics. The truth is that we are in a very challenging season in our nation. Not only are we dealing with COVID-19, not only are we facing racial injustice and seeking equality, not only are there fires and hurricanes causing devastation and death, but we are also in the midst of a contentious, even ugly political election time. When we are in challenging times like this, looking to Jesus is a wise response. Jesus, who lived out his teachings and values by example, Jesus, whose loving, liberating, and life-giving way changed and informed how people saw and thought about God and each other. Jesus, whose revolution of love and reformation of life set the way for a renewal of our relationship with God, each other, and all of creation. The countercultural Jesus, who said things such as, "Blessed are the peacemakers, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, love your neighbor as yourself." This election season, I don't particularly care if you are Republican, Democrat, or Independent. I am not trying to criticize or affirm your candidates or how you vote. The purpose of this series is to help you reflect, to help all of us reflect on the values and loves of Jesus so that our thoughts and our actions, our social values and our political agendas align with that of Jesus. In this contentious, polarized environment, I think that it is important whenever possible that we don't see and make winners and losers. You see, when we think in terms of winners and losers, our mindset to others becomes uncharitable. But when we strive to think with the mindset and see with the eyes of Jesus of Nazareth, we find that we are better ready to be unwilling to be co-opted by the powers that be. We find ourselves undeterred in reaching out to the lonely and the needy, the poor, the excluded, the lost, the stranger, the grieving, the struggling, the rejected. When we mold our lives after Jesus, who looked out for the good and the well-being, the welfare, their salvation and the redemption of others, then we begin to be changed, and we bring about the very change that is needed in this world. In this series, we will explore several powerful and important questions that Jesus asked. The neighbor question, the image question, the truth question, the power question, the fear question, the Caesar question, the peacemaker question, the discipleship question. And we will grow to know the heart and mind of Jesus better and hopefully be challenged to pattern our own hearts and minds and souls and actions after his. Following the hymn, we are going to begin our reflections today listening to our Minnesota Bishop, Bruce Ough, share his annual address to all our congregations called A Light Rising in the Darkness. His spouse, Char, will share scripture. As we prepare to be challenged and inspired, let us sing together.
Please join me in singing the first three verses of Yesu, Yesu.
Thank you. A reading from the prophet Isaiah. Is not this the fast that I choose? To loose the bonds of injustice? To undo the thongs of the yoke? To let the oppressed go free? And to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them, and not to hide yourself from your own kin? Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator should go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." If he remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness. A reading from the Gospel of Matthew. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt loses its saltiness, how will it become salty again? It's good for nothing except to be thrown away and trampled under people's feet. You are the light of the world. A city on top of a hill can't be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a basket. Instead, they put it on the top of a lampstand, and it shines on all who are in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before people, so they can see the good things you do and praise your Father who is in heaven. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Abundant grace and peace to you as we gather for this unusual but necessary virtual session of the Minnesota Conference. Paul's prayer for the Ephesians is my prayer for us this day. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give us a spirit of wisdom and revelation as we come to know him, so that with the eyes of our hearts enlightened, we may know what is the hope to which God has called us. Friends, I don't know about you, but I have about reached my limit of disruption, disappointment, grief, and uncertainty. Our lives, our churches, our ministries, our communities, our world have been turned upside down. The dislocation and abrupt forced adaptation has been overwhelming. We have been driven to our computer screens, social distancing, online worship, and mask wearing by the coronavirus pandemic. We have been driven to our streets and knees in anguish and repentance by the George Floyd killing and the renewed cries to dismantle racism in all our institutions. We have been driven to frustration and renewed disappointment by the lingering uncertainty and unresolved division within our denomination by the postponement of general and jurisdictional conferences. We have been driven to spiritual and emotional exhaustion by the demands of a new normal that is anything but normal. We grieve the loss of church as we have known it, even as we struggle to fan the tender embers of a new church yearning to be born. And our grief is compounded by the death of those struck down by COVID-19 and the dear family members and colleagues whose ministries and witness we honor this day. I know we are in a liminal, divergent time, but honestly, I find myself often longing for the familiarity of a more linear, less complex season, if only for a respite. In the midst of our being overwhelmed by disruption, death, disappointment, and despair, God speaks to us through the prophet Isaiah. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing praise to God from the end of the earth. Isaiah knew what he was talking about. He was speaking to his people exiled in Babylon. He was speaking to a refugee people forced into slavery. He was speaking to a people beaten down by the ruthless separation of families, the slaughter of innocent children, the destruction of their culture. He was speaking to a people worn down by despair, a people who had lost hope, a people being bombarded by tragedy and death. And Isaiah is speaking to us today. The message is clear. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing praise to God from the end of the earth. We are able to sing to the Lord a new song because God is in the business of bringing the captives home. God is in the business of healing the people's wounds. God is in the business of wiping away the tears of grief. God is in the business of raising the dead. God is in the business of creating something new out of chaos and confusion. The reasons for striking up a new song in this liminal and divergent season is because God has already promised to deliver us, to never let us go, to hold us in the palm of God's hand, and to lift us up as on eagle's wings. The only appropriate response to God's promise, made fully known to us in Jesus' resurrection, is to sing to the Lord a new song. The new thing God is doing in our lives, in our churches, in our denomination, in our communities, demands a new song. A resurrection demands a new voice. The new creation demands we live the hope to which we have been called. Isaiah reminded his exiled people that the hope to which God had called him, the song they were to sing anew, was that they were to be a light to the world. Isaiah called Israel to let their good works shine and illuminate a dark, chaotic world. Jesus echoed this same calling for his followers in his Sermon on the Mount. He teaches us that we are to live hope by letting your light shine before people so they can see the good things you do and praise your Father who is in heaven. Jesus does another one of those great inversion things. He is the light of the world, but now he tells his disciples, "You are the light of the world." Or as Eugene Peterson paraphrases it in the Message, "We are here to be light, bringing out the God colors in this world." And Jesus meant the entire world. It is no mistake, he told his disciples, to not hide their light under a basket. It is no mistake, Jesus told his disciples, to be his witnesses beyond Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. From the beginning, Jesus knew we would have a tendency to cling to what we already know, to gravitate toward Jerusalem, to limit our witness to 1 hour on Sunday morning with people we already know, to become captives to our preferences and to settle for that what makes us comfortable. Let there be no mistake what the scriptural imperatives are for being the light and living hope in the world. Hold on now. Here is what it looks like for Isaiah. This is going to sound a lot like what you have been saying and hearing on the streets of Minneapolis, St. Paul, and hundreds of other cities around the world since the George Floyd killing. Are you ready? Break the chains of injustice. Get rid of exploitation in the workplace. Free the oppressed. Cancel debts. Share your food with the hungry. Invite the homeless poor into your homes. Put clothes on the shivering ill-clad. Be available to your own family. Stand with those who are oppressed. 700 years later, Jesus rose to preach in his hometown synagogue in Nazareth and echoed this same call to be the light and live hope as he inaugurated his own ministry. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the prisoners and recovery of sight to the blind, to liberate the oppressed, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Isaiah's prophecy does not end with a laundry list of what it looks like to be the light to the world. It ends with a promise from the Lord. "If you do these things," Isaiah says, "then your light shall break forth like dawn, and your light shall rise in the darkness." It's a powerful vision, isn't it? Nearly every day for 8 years, I have prayed that the Holy Spirit would enable this vision to break through in each of our 350 congregations in Minnesota. Even as Shar and I head into retirement, I will continue to pray that every one of our congregations will be a light rising in the darkness of injustice, hopelessness, cynicism, and sin. That every one of our congregations will be a light in the world, reaching new people and bringing them out of darkness into Christ's marvelous light, saving light. A light in the world, building the capacity of Jesus' followers to love God and love neighbor. A light in the world, healing the world's brokenness. A light rising in the darkness. Our world has changed, and our methods of doing ministry have changed. The church can no longer rely on the traditional attractional model of ministry. Being a leader in the church today requires a new imagination for what the church looks like and acts like. But what has not changed is our mission of making disciples of Jesus Christ who are equipped and motivated to change the world. So I call on Peter's images written to the small, beleaguered churches of Asia Minor to remind you, Minnesota United Methodists, who you are. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, so that you may proclaim the mighty acts of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. One of the most powerful and compelling phrases in all of Scripture is, so that. The prophets often urge the people to repent or remember, so that. The gospel writers frequently concluded their reports of Jesus' teachings with the phrase, so that. This little phrase, so that, is about alignment. We do something so that we get the impact or results we seek. We continue something or change something we are doing so that we reflect the values we hold. We take certain actions so that our mission and vision become our current reality. We plead with God for a clean heart so that our spirits are aligned with God's own spirit. We pray the Lord's Prayer so that there will be alignment between the kingdom on earth and the kingdom in heaven. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. For the past 8 years, the Minnesota Conference has been on a shared journey toward vitality. We have realigned and focused our resources so that every congregation could become a vital expression of the scriptural imperatives to grow in love of God and neighbor, reach new people, and heal a broken world. We conducted the Reach, Renew, Rejoice campaign so that we could start new congregations, renew existing churches, and develop a multiplication culture. We developed a robust clergy leadership, recruitment, and formation strategy, including our ELI internship program, so that we could better support our clergy and call forth and equip the next generation of bold spirit leaders. We launched a breakthrough prayer movement so that all our renewal efforts would be bathed in prayer and Holy Spirit-led. We launched generous givers and stewardship workshops and expanded our financial revenue streams so that we could call forth God's abundant resources for mission and remain a vital, sustainable conference in the future. We engaged in ministry with the poor and a variety of global health initiatives so that our congregations could transform their communities by welcoming all to the banquet table. We have invested in our camping ministry so that more young persons are introduced to Christ's transformative love. We approved an aspirational vision in June 2019 so that we can become a fully inclusive conference committed to justice and reconciliation, anchored in Jesus, our Wesleyan way of life, and the evangelistic task. We are addressing issues of systemic racism and privilege with renewed energy so that we can become a more diverse, inclusive expression of the kingdom of God. We are committed to staying together and staying strong so that we can make good decisions from a position of strength for all congregations on the other side of the postponed General Conference. We are working to leverage technology and develop online resources and learning platforms so that we can better support congregations and leaders in a new virtual church world. Yes, the world has changed. Ministry has new profound challenges, but the call to leave Jerusalem and go into the world to make and equip disciples has not changed. So remember who you are. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, so that you may proclaim the mighty acts of Jesus who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light and calls you even again today to be the light of the world rising in the darkness. I was very close to my grandmother, O. When I was in college, I was called to her bedside as she lay dying. At one point during my vigil, she took my hand and said to me, "God has an important thing for you to do. I want you to say yes." She wasn't any more specific. Only, "God has an important thing for you to do. Say yes." I have been saying yes to God ever since because I didn't want to miss that important thing. My grandmother called me forth and in a very real sense ordained me that day. Oh, I have had a Board of Ordained Ministry vote to approve me for ordination. I have had a bishop lay his hands on my head and set me apart for ordained ministry in the church. I've had the church elect and consecrate me as a bishop, but it was my grandmother who placed the mantle of call upon my shoulders by requesting I always say yes. Isn't that what baptism is about? Saying yes? Isn't that what being a disciple is about? Saying yes? Isn't that what being part of a movement to spread scriptural holiness across the land is about? Saying yes? Isn't that what ordination and consecration are about? Saying yes? Isn't that why we have gathered in this virtual conference to say yes again and again? Our presence today is not about you or about me. It's about God. It is about saying yes to the Lord of our lives. It is about saying yes to being the light and living hope, even when our first impulse is to say no or not yet. Kathleen Norris, in her book, Cloister Walk, got it correct when she wrote, "With God, there is always more unfolding. That what we can glimpse of the divine is always exactly enough and never enough." This unfolding nature of God's will and mission is why we have the opportunity and the need to say yes every day, so we don't miss the important thing God in Christ is calling us to do. So I pray, gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit on your beloved people of the Minnesota Conference. Constantly bend them to your will and your love for mercy, justice, and compassion. Grant them your gifts and courage and impulse to always say yes, to bring the light to the world, a beacon of hope in the darkness. I pray all of this in the precious name of Jesus. And friends, the church said, yes. Thank you.
Thank you, Bishop, for that inspiring message. I am sure that you, like me, are thinking about where you can say yes to the God who calls us to be the salt of the earth. And so as we move into our offering time, I invite you to continue to ask the questions. What are ways that you can give of your time and your talents, your service, your prayers, so that people in our community will know God's love? What are things that you can do so that your life is an offering to God? What can you offer so that you can be a beacon of hope in a hurting world? God has an important thing for you to do today. So please say yes today and every day. Amen.
Thank you. join us in singing, "Lord, We Come to Ask Your Healing."
Hasn't it been good being in worship together? Make sure to stay to the very end because there is more music and inspiration still to come. Next Sunday, we will continue reclaiming Jesus as Pastor Cynthia explores with us the image question. I told you at the beginning of the service that Ann Gustafson, our director of operations, is leaving us, and if you or someone you know is looking for a full-time job in that area, please let me or Steve Mattson, our personnel team chair, or Cindy Headland, one of our lay leaders, know. But for today, may we say yes when God calls us to do or say or stand for someone or something, so that the world will know the inclusion, justice, grace, and love that God wants for us. May it be so. Amen. Amen.